Blessed be God, most holy, glorious, and undivided Trinity. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. With you. Let us pray. Give us grace, O Lord, to answer readily the call of your Savior Jesus Christ and proclaim to all people the good news of his salvation, that we and the whole world may perceive the glory of his marvelous works, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Nehemiah. All the people gathered together into the square before the water gate. They told the scribe Ezra to bring the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had given to Israel. Accordingly, the priest Ezra brought the law before the assembly, both men and women and all who could hear with understanding. This was on the first day of the seventh month. He read from it facing the square before the water gate from early morning until midday in the presence of the men and women and those who could understand. And the ears of all the people were attentive to the book of the law. And Ezra opened the book in the sight of all the people, for he was standing above all the people. And when he opened it, all the people stood up. Then Ezra blessed the Lord, the great God, and all the people answered, "Amen, amen," lifting up their hands. Then they bowed their heads and worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. So they read from the book, from the law of God, with interpretation. They gave the sense so that the people understood the reading. And Nehemiah, who was the governor, and Ezra the priest and scribes and the Levites who taught the people, said to the people, "This day is holy to the Lord your God. Do not mourn or weep." For all the people wept when they heard the words of the law. Then he said to them, "Go your way. Eat the fat and drink sweet wine and send portions of those to those for whom nothing is prepared, for this day is holy to our Lord. And do not be grieved, for the joy of the Lord is your strength." Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people. First letter to the church in Corinth. Just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in the one Spirit we were all baptized into the one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and were all made to drink of one Spirit. Indeed, the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot would say, "Because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body," that would not make it any less a part of the body. And if the ear would say, "Because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body," that would not make it any less than part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the hearing be? If the whole body were hearing, where would the sense of smell be? But as it is, God arranged the members in the body, each one of them, as he chose. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many members, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, "I have no need of you," nor again the head to the feet, "I have no need of you." On the contrary, the members of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable, and those members of the body that we think less honorable, we clothe with great honor. and our less respectable members are treated with greater respect, whereas our more respectable members do not need this. But God has so arranged the body, giving the greater honor to the inferior member, that there be no dissension within the body, but the members may have the same care for one another. If one member suffers, all suffer together with it. If one member is honored, all rejoice together with it. Now you are the body of Christ and individually members of it. And God has appointed in the church first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, then deeds of power, then gifts of healing, forms of assistance, forms of leadership, various kinds of tongues. All are apostles, all are prophets, all are teachers. Do all work miracles? Do all possess gifts of healing? Do all speak in tongues? Do all interpret? But strive for the greater gifts. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
The Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke. Jesus, filled with the power of the Spirit, returned to Galilee, and a report about him spread through all the surrounding country. He began to teach in their synagogues and was praised by everyone. When he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. She has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. Then he began to say to them, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." The Gospel of the Lord.
Thank you. Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. I want to start by saying how truly honored and grateful I am to be here with you today. Standing up here after my journey the last few years, this is really a special moment for me. So I want to say thank you to Reverend Cindy for the opportunity, and thank you to each and every one of you as well. Now, the word gospel is derived from the term good news. So when we read and when we hear the gospel, we are reading and we are hearing the good news of the story of Christ's life and the implications that that has on our lives today. But as we all well know, hearing something and reading something doesn't always mean accepting it, and seeing something doesn't always mean believing it. So in our gospel reading today, Jesus has just returned from the wilderness where he was tempted, and word is starting to get out about him. He's creating a buzz in the area. People are coming to hear him teach. So on the Sabbath, Jesus returns home, and as is customary, he goes into the synagogue, and he's invited as a guest to read. So Jesus unrolls the scroll, and he proceeds to read a prophecy from the prophet Isaiah regarding bringing good news to the poor, freedom to the captive, and sight to the blind. Now, I want to pause here for a moment, and I want to give you a little bit of context to the importance of this passage that Jesus reads. So if you go well over 700 years prior to Jesus' life, you first had the kingdom of Israel being conquered by the Assyrian Empire. And then a little over 100 years roughly after that, you had the kingdom of Judah being conquered and led into exile by the Babylonians. So a number of decades go by with them in exile in Babylon. And then finally you have Persian king Cyrus the Great who comes along. And he conquers Babylon. And then he decrees that a group of exiles can go back and rebuild the temple. So you have this group of exiles who are allowed to return home. And the reality is because so many decades had passed, many of them had no real firsthand memory or knowledge of where they were going back to. They had stories and legends from their family and their descendants, but they had no real memory of this once great temple and city. So obviously what they arrive back to is not the same as the stories they were told. The temple has been torn down. The city is somewhat in ruins. And really there's this kind of great sense of disappointment amongst the exiles who have returned. So this prophecy from Isaiah, it comes at just the right time to kind of rekindle that fire of hope in them and give them something to cling to as they work to begin rebuilding the temple. So now let's come back to our gospel passage where a little over 500 years have passed since that prophecy from Isaiah. And once again, the Jewish people find themselves under occupation, this time from the Roman Empire, and once again, here they are with that familiar feeling of longing for freedom from their oppressor. So, back to the synagogue, Jesus has just read from the scroll, and as was the custom, he goes and he has a seat. All eyes are on him. This is his moment. What is he going to say? And with one sentence, he makes pretty much the most bold and audacious claim you can make. Today, this prophecy has been fulfilled in your hearing. These are powerful, powerful words that he speaks. Words that carry a lot of hope and meaning. Truly good news. But, as we are going to read next week in the gospel passage, many of the people, just because they heard Jesus say that, they didn't really accept it. And even though they saw him and things play out through his life in front of their eyes, they didn't really believe it. So throughout Jesus' life, he continues to bring this message of this new kingdom, this new way of living, of unconditional love. But many people who saw it, they simply didn't believe it because it didn't line up with the good news that they were wanting to hear. You have to remember, at the time, these people, their idea of good news was a Messiah or a Savior who was going to come and free them from their captivity, restore their kingdom to its prior glory. So ultimately, good news for them had to equal bad news for their oppressor, and in this case, that was the Romans. But Jesus, he's not here to usher in their expectation of freedom. Jesus came to reorder the world and usher in God's kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. This kingdom is an entirely new way of viewing our human existence, one of unconditional love and acceptance and equality and inclusivity of all. One where the poor are taken care of, one where the hungry are fed, one where the lonely are brought into family, one where the good of all takes precedent over the good of just a few. And ultimately, it's one where we have to learn to find peace, purpose, and contentment even amidst the difficulties and the circumstances that life brings. Now, I think we have a lot of parallels with this story today in our time. As the body of Christ, it's our job to continue following the Spirit to bring that good news of Christ to a world who so desperately needs to hear it, but it seems like it falls on deaf ears more times than not. People just have a hard time hearing and accepting this good news. And unfortunately, a lot of that is because it has become so distorted over the years that what they think we're trying to say is not really what we're trying to say. And then even for those of us who we call ourselves followers of Christ, it can even be hard for us when we look around the world that we live in right now and we think, this can't be it. Is this good news? Is this legit? Is this real? We find ourselves 2 years into a pandemic, and it seems like we've lost hope for life to go back to the pre-COVID way. The political divide, especially in our country, is only magnified through social media and technology. There seems to be so much anger and hatred and vitriol, and it's definitely not the life that any of us hoped we would be living here in 2022. But I truly believe that just like the people that Jesus was speaking to in his time, we have to kind of have this mentality shift where we learn that good news, the good news of God's kingdom, it's not always going to mean the changing of the difficult circumstances that we find ourselves in our lives. However, it means this, that what we choose to participate in and how we choose to act regardless of the circumstances of life can still be good. On August 30th, 2018, I had to learn this lesson the hardest way possible. Kayla and I had just moved back from New York about 3 months prior, and I spent the majority of our time back in California, just sick out of nowhere. In and out of doctor's offices, in and out of the ER, numerous tests, everything you can imagine under the sun, was misdiagnosed numerous times. Finally have a doctor who says, hey, I'm just going to throw a Hail Mary here, and we're going to run a CT scan. Little did I know my life was about to change. Obviously, I was not expecting the news that I had cancer. So much so that our doctor's office was 2 blocks from our apartment. So Kayla and I were in the car, and I was like, hey, I'm going to run in here, get these results really quick. He should have them by now. Just stay in the car. I'll be back in a second. Only to 5 minutes later have to call her into the office as I stood there trembling, thinking my life was over. Now, had surgery. We found out the cancer was a little worse than we thought. It was stage 3. So that meant now I have to go through treatment for a year, and I have to, for the rest of my life, until we find a cure, I am going to have to go a few times a year and be tested, because there is a possibility, and even though the longer I go, the better my odds are, there's still a small possibility that it could come back. Let me tell you, when you're in your mid-30s, that is not a circumstance in life that you want to face. I felt like my life was over. I felt like I lost the good news. There was no longer good news for me. Everything was bad. And I was essentially living on a scan-to-scan lease. So I got a scan. If it was clear, I had 3 months till the next one. So I seemed to have lost my purpose, my hope for a better life for myself, for my wife. But it took years of counseling with Reverend Cindy and Father Richard and spiritual direction to come to the realization that I am never going to be able to change this circumstance. I'm a cancer patient. It is what it is. I'm going to constantly have to go be scanned until, hopefully, we find a cure. I cannot change that circumstance. But I cannot just crawl into a hole and live the rest of my life as if I've lost everything, as if there is no good, as if there is no happiness. So I had to make a conscious decision. I'm going to move forward with my life. And you know what? It's not always easy. Life is really hard. But I've learned to find the good in spite of my circumstances. And we all have to realize that. We can't change certain things in life. We can't change certain things in our world. We can't change our health. We can't change this pandemic. But the only thing we can control and we can change is how we choose to respond in the midst of that uncertainty. We can't control how people choose to vote and what they believe politically, but we can control how we treat them and how we love them. We can't control, and this is a tough one, we cannot control people's opinions on the vaccine or wearing a mask. But we can control how we show kindness and acceptance and grace to everyone. And here's what that means. That means kindness to those who get so angry that they have to wear a mask inside, as well as kindness to those who are so scared that they wear a mask when they're alone in their car driving down the freeway. It means showing kindness to everyone. We can still choose to seek out those in need and help them. We can choose to seek out those who are poor, those who are hungry and feed them, those who are lonely and bring them into our family. And I believe that when we follow the Spirit's guiding in our life in the work of the kingdom of God and showing that love and making those decisions, that even in the midst of the uncertainty of the times that we live in, even in the midst of whatever we're going on in our lives, life can still be good. We can still have purpose and we can still have love. And that is truly good news. Amen.
Now let us stand and proclaim the good news of our faith using the words of the Nicene Creed found on page 9. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. God of all people, you have brought us together to hear your Son proclaim the good news. Hear the prayers of the people that we may be moved to minister to the poor, release to the captives, and work toward freedom for the oppressed.
Bless the Church Universal in all parts of the world. We give thanks for St. James and St. Michael's, our sister parish, as we both strive to be welcoming and inclusive communities of faith. Hear us, God of our faith. We pray for peace on earth, especially relief from political tensions between Russia and Ukraine, Israel and the Palestinian people, Syria, North Korea, and among countries on the African continent. Hear us, God of all nations. We pray for those who feel compelled towards theft, violence, and harm to our already fragile social problems in our divided country. Bring us together as Christ taught us to love one another. Hear us, God of peace. Whatever our spiritual gifts, gifts of wisdom, faith, prophetic witness, art, music, hospitality, pastoral care, or administration, may we use them for the common good. Hear us, God of love. We pray for relief from the coronavirus pandemic and ask that you care for all those who suffer from all illnesses, pain, loneliness, hunger, homelessness, addiction, anxiety, or suicidal thoughts. We pray for your healing to touch us all. Hear us, God, healer. We remember those who have passed from this earthly realm and now reside in your heavenly kingdom. Bring comfort to those who miss and mourn their loved ones. Hear us, God of eternal rest.
Gracious God, grant that we may hear your holy scriptures and read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that comforted by your promises, we may embrace and forever hold fast to the hope of eternal life. Through and in Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. And now let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins for our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Okay. Let's simmer down, people. Class is about to begin. No, I'm just kidding. Welcome to St. James. I'm so glad you're here with us, and welcome to our virtual congregation. We're glad you're with us also. So we have some new people, I think. If you are new to St. James, we would like to just outright mug you right now. No one's going to admit it. We have a gift for you if you'd like to. Do we have anyone new? We would just like to give you a little, you can be brave. Oh, there we go. We have a victim. Okay, welcome to St. James. You're being mugged and kissed this morning. Thank you for being here. If you would like more information, there's a little information card in the front of the pew. Fill that out, pop it in the usher, as the ushers go by with the offering plate, and we'll be in touch with you. Okay, so everyone turn to page 19 in your bulletin. We have a new chef. Chef Matt Green, and he has prepared a brunch for us today after the service, after the annual meeting. Chef Matt comes from Temecula. He's owned restaurants. He's extremely qualified. He wants to help serve us and be part of this congregation, and I just want you to make a huge welcome, and he's supposed to be here right now. Oh, he is. Oh, come on. Thanks for that. I was stalling thinking you were coming through here. So he's also sneaky, so be careful. Anyway, we welcome Matt. Thank you so much for being with us, Matt. We're looking forward to the year ahead of us. Of course, after the service is the annual meeting. Just please remain seated. We'll go right into the meeting, and we'll then go into our brunch. She's an amazing cook, so we're really, really excited. If you don't have an annual report, it has a pink unicorn on the front cover, which has supposedly hit the parade. I guess it came through the internet that we have a great annual report. So if you don't, the ushers are ready to hand you out one so you're ready to go. Ushers, annual report. Oh, hair on fire back there. Page 20, if you would like to join this choir, the wonderful choir, please see Mark. His email address is in the bulletin, and you can join the ranks of this wonderful choir. Universal Christ, the next meeting is February 13th in the lab. You can join up anytime. I highly recommend, if you want a deeper understanding of your spirituality, that you join this amazing group of people. Like I said, you can join anytime. Inner Sanctuary is also looking into the Universal Christ Tuesday mornings at 10:30 here at the church. So I thought I would read to you another email I received. This is from the Cortez family, Ron and Lori. You probably don't know them as much because all the pandemic hit and they were starting to come. But he was the treasurer of UCI, actually vice president, way high up there at UCI. He wrote to me, let's see, January 16th. Reverend Cindy, we are thankful to have you as our pastor. While we are not physically at church, we do watch your church service virtually from Washington, D.C. We wanted to take time to compliment you on developing a virtual broadcast of the Mass. In this manner, we can stay part of the parish even though we're in D.C. We still have our home in Irvine coming back at least once a month. Be safe and keep up the great work. Well, he says something very nice about my leadership. I won't repeat it. May God bless you. Ron Cortez, Undersecretary for Administration, Smithsonian Institute. So, if you're watching, Ron and Lori, thank you so much for the email. And that's just your outreach. That's you people understanding that we have to keep connected even during the pandemic. So God bless you as you continue to give to this ministry.
From all that dwell below the skies, let the Creator treasure rise, let the Redeemer's name be sung.
kind of a tough act to follow, guys. There we go. Thank you, Meg. Things come from you, O Lord. Thank you. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, because in the mystery of the Word made flesh, you have caused a new light to shine in our hearts, to give the knowledge of your glory in the face of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your words spoken through your prophets, and above all in Jesus Christ, the Word made flesh. For in these last days you sent Jesus to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In Christ you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In Christ, you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Savior Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, Jesus took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember Christ's death, we proclaim Christ's resurrection, we await Christ's coming in glory. And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Savior of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us in the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, through whom we are acceptable to you, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country, where with St. James and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your children. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. This is the banquet of the Lamb. It is made ready for those who love him and for those who want to love him more. So come. You have much faith and you have little. You have been here often and you have not been here long. You have tried to follow and you have failed. Come, because it is the Lord who invites you, the gifts of God for the people of God.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Radiant God, with our eyes we have seen your salvation, and in this meal we have feasted on your grace. May your word take flesh in us, so that we may be your holy people, revealing your glory made known to us in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. May Christ, the Son of God, be made manifest in you, that your lives may be a light to the world. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you forever. Amen.
Thank you. okay, I can do that.
Our services here at St. James are meant to be shared, and I'm so glad you've joined us today. Hi, I'm Reverend Cindy Voorhees, a priest here at St. James, Newport Beach. Every week we come together with music and a short message to help you grow in your spiritual journey. And we hope today's worship was something you experienced personally and have enjoyed the love and energy of our ministry. Everyone has been wonderful and generous during this tough pandemic. We have found new ways to worship together every Sunday, and all of you have helped make this possible, and we want to thank you. Online streaming church in many ways costs more and creates different challenges, like how do people know how to support our ministry and where to give? As we move ahead, we depend on you to do your part. So please consider making a donation to St. James Episcopal Church using the information provided below. Sharing your gifts with others will make a difference in reaching more people who truly need us now more than ever. Remember, engage your faith. God bless you, and thank you for supporting St. James.